crack, and then this bound, this upper bound for the axial force. And yesterday we also considered stability, and we have proved that for a configuration without jumps, and which satisfies this inequality in a strict way, we have metastability. Okay? And we have two more properties of stabilities to prove today. The second property which we wish to prove is we consider a configuration with one jump, just one, and so number of u equal to one, and we consider the following inequality, L theta double prime of the jump plus w double prime of u prime greater than zero. So what we wish to prove is that this situation, I mean all configurations with one jump which satisfies this equality, inequality, are stable. And to prove this, we need this Lagrange, this exact expansion with the Lagrange remainder I was starting to speak about yesterday. So we take the energy is the sum of these two parts. Then I evaluate this first part at a perturbed configuration. U prime is now constant. And I make an expansion before making the expansion, I can write, using the Jensen inequality, which we proved yesterday, this is greater or equal than L multiplied by W U prime minus 1 over L, the jump, the sum of the jumps of eta, which yesterday indicated this way. Okay, so this is simply the Jensen inequality applied to this perturbation. Okay, and now we expand this expression here, and we have L, which multiplies W of U prime plus minus W prime, because we have a minus here, W prime of U prime multiplied by the sum of the jumps and then we take a second order term in this way, 1 over 2 1 over L square W prime of U prime plus Xi multiplied by the sum of the jumps of the jumps of eta. The blackboard is always short, multiplied by the sum of the jumps square. This is the exact expansion. And for the second term, we do the same. So sum of theta of the jump of u plus the jump of eta so I have to explain here what means this sum. We have one jump for u, and for eta we have any number of jumps. So there may be one term in which we have the jump of u plus maybe a jump of eta, which may be zero at that point, plus all the other jumps of eta with the jump of u equal to zero. Okay, so we have to understand this sum in this way. And if we use the subadditivity property, which we proved yesterday, this is greater or equal than theta of the sum. The sum is exactly the unique jump of u plus the sum of the eta, which I have denoted this way. And at this point, we make the expansion exactly like here. So this is theta of u plus theta prime of u multiplied by the sum of the jumps of eta plus 1/2 theta double prime of the jump of u plus xi zero, which is different from this xi in general, multiplied the sum of the jumps and everything by this term. Okay, so this xi zero and this xi are between zero and one. Okay, we have this. Then, if we take the difference between the energy of the perturbed configuration minus the energy of the initial configuration, we I can sum the two of them and I get this. Okay. Then, if I sum the first two terms, I get this. If I look at the first order terms, we know that w prime of u prime is equal to theta prime of u by equilibrium. So I have here I have eta, and here I have, this is eta, with a minus sign, L cancels with L, so it is zero. Okay, so what remains is just the sum of the second order terms. So I write here, I have an L which cancels with one of them, so I have 1 over 2L, W double prime of U prime plus Xi sum of the eta multiplied by eta sum square plus 1 over 2 theta double prime of u plus xi zero eta multiplied again by this square. Okay, and this is an exact formula, there is no remainder. Okay, at this point we must introduce some continuity. Assumption, and the continuity concerns these functions w double prime and theta double prime. I didn't say anything before, but now we are assuming that these w and these theta are as smooth as we want. Okay, so in particular the second derivatives are continuous. Okay, so what means, for instance, that w double prime is continuous means that for every epsilon greater than zero, there is a delta less than zero, such that W of this argument here, U prime plus xi eta, let me write just eta, less than delta implies that continuous is such that eta less than delta implies this less than epsilon. Yes. Okay. Why I didn't put the xi here? Because if it holds with xi equal to 1, it automatically holds for smaller xi. Okay. So if I take this sum of the jumps sufficiently small, I have that this is greater or equal than this minus epsilon. Okay. So I have 1 over 2L W W prime of U prime minus epsilon, minus epsilon I write it here, 1 over 2L epsilon. And the same I can do about theta. So I can write 1 over 2 theta double prime of the jump minus epsilon. So I collect these, and everything is multiplied by this eta square, which is everywhere. But now I have assumed that this sum here, you see, is strictly positive. It's a positive number, this sum here. So I have a positive number plus something depending on epsilon. So if I take epsilon sufficiently small, this is positive. So we have we have proved that this U is a minimum in which class of functions? In the class of functions in which this inequality holds. Okay, but we have that here I should put an absolute value, but we know. Oh, okay, I will put it because. It may be exactly on U, etc. So this is the correct way. So we know that this absolute value is less or equal than the norm of eta. Okay? Because the norm of eta is just this sum plus an integral term, positive. So if I take this norm less than delta, this is less than delta, and that difference is less than epsilon. And I have, I have a local minimum, because this inequality there holds for all eta less than delta. No, Dardel is out of this analysis. Barenblatt is inside. Yes, yes, yeah. Oh, of course, you can regularize. You can do whatever you wish. So this is a second property we had to prove. And let's prove the last one. The last property is that if the number of U of the discontinuity so is greater than 1, we have instability. And this is easy to prove because it is sufficient to take a perturbation for which the second variation is negative. Okay, and we take a perturbation of this type. This is the x-axis, and we take a perturbation eta this way. So we have at least two jump points. Okay, let they be x1 and x2. Maybe there are others, but two are enough. And we take an eta made this way. This is a positive number, a, okay? And we take an eta with plus a jump plus a here and minus a here. We can do this because they are jump points, so the sign of the of eta is arbitrary, okay? So let's take a perturbation of this type. If we evaluate this, so a of u plus eta, this is equal to the integral. You see, when I take a perturbation of this type and I write the boundary condition, eta prime can be well equal to zero because I have the integral of eta prime plus one jump plus the other jump, which is automatically zero. Okay, so here I take eta prime equal to zero. So here I just have w of u prime, which is a constant. And then I have sum of theta. Okay, so it is convenient. Okay, let's write this way. Theta of u plus eta. And E of u is that one. Huh? I take the difference. Sorry? Oh, yeah, 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 sure. Theta of this. So if I take the difference, this term cancels. And all these terms cancel except the two which have the eta. So I have here plus theta of u x1 plus a minus theta of u x1 plus theta u x2 minus a minus theta u x2. Okay, okay, and now I can expand. This is equal, it is not plus equal. Okay, I may expand this in this starting taking this as a starting point. So I have that this is equal to this plus theta prime of u x1 multiplied by a plus 1/2 theta double prime u x1 multiplied by a square. And the same for the others. For the others, so here I have a minus multiplied by a plus 1 theta double prime x square, not x, a square. Okay, so it is clear that this theta prime is equal to this theta prime because both are equal to sigma by equilibrium. So this term and this term cancels. And then we have these theta double primes, which are negative because we are supposing that theta double prime, that theta is concave. Okay. So perhaps I should have said this before, because just at the beginning, because even property two, we use the additivity, which implies concavity. Okay. So to be clear, the properties of equilibrium make no assumption on theta. Okay. They hold for any theta. The properties of metastability require concavity. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Need not to be strict. You're right. Oh, yeah. And so we have proved this. Of course, this is negative. This is negative. We have a difference which is negative, and this cannot be a minimum. So it is unstable. So let me just copy here these two results, which we will use in the. Theta L theta double prime plus W double prime of U prime strictly positive is again metastability, and number of jumps greater than one implies instability. Okay, so we have a picture about equilibrium configurations and about their stability, at least in the concave case. Sorry? Yeah. No, but. I don't make explicit proofs for the rest, but I will say something later. Okay. No? Here. Yes? Okay, this is a good question. I should have said this before. Of course, you may suppose that W is not convex. But in this case, you have a combination of change of phase plus fracture, which is very conceivable to study. But I didn't do this simply because I wish to make a simple model. But of course, you can study the interaction of the two. Okay, so let's go back to the picture. Qui dovrei accendere il computer. Se ci sono sopra i disegni di ieri, li riproiettiamo. I recall the picture that I showed yesterday, in which we had a two-dimensional configuration space. Okay, and for the equilibrium configurations. And now we have a good justification for that, because U prime is a constant, and that's okay. But if we have more than one discontinuity, we have instability. So we can, this justifies fully to use a two-dimensional configuration space for the Barenblatt case. And I had made a picture of the energy, which was something like this. A curved a surface of this type. Now we can make a picture of the equilibrium configurations. That is, So let's forget for the moment about stability and let's go back to equilibrium. Stability will be useful later. So this is my configuration space. If you remember, in this configuration space, in the Griffith case, the equilibrium configurations were on the axis, okay? Because we had the non-factored configuration and the factored configuration with u prime equal to zero. Now we have different equilibrium configuration. We still have equilibrium configuration with unfactored equilibrium configuration, but it is not the whole line because of this bound here. Because we have a bound which tells us that the w prime of u prime must be less or equal than theta prime of zero. Okay? And because W is strictly convex, W prime is strictly monotonic and has an inverse. So we can write, and applying the inverse, the inequality is preserved. So we have that U prime has to be less or equal than W prime to the minus 1 multiplied by theta prime of 0. And this I called beta sub c. Why beta? Because until this critical point, u prime is equal to beta because there are no jumps. Okay? So I have a beta c somewhere here, and the equilibrium configurations end here. We have an upper bound on u prime. And then, in place of having the horizontal axis, we have a curve, precisely the curve w prime of u prime equal theta prime of u, jump of u, which we can represent, if you wish, as u prime equal to w prime to the minus 1 of theta prime of u. So it is a curve which starts from here and tends asymptotically to zero. We don't the shape of this curve depends on the shape of theta, and I assume for the following that it is convex. Okay, but this is not need not be true. I just restrict my analysis to the case in which this curve or equilibrium configuration is convex. So we have a picture of this type. So what happens when we load? When we load the we apply the beta. So in this picture yesterday, we saw that there was a loading line which was progressing in this way. Okay, here the loading lines are the brown lines there. Okay, so I have in black the equilibrium curves, and the brown curves are the loading lines for increasing beta. Okay, so you see that, as I said yesterday, the slope of this curve is of this line is minus 1 over L, just because here you have beta and here you have beta L as it is shown there. Okay, so if it comes out that this slope beta over L is very steep, for every value of beta we have just one intersection with the equilibrium curve. So in this case, we start from here, we go up to this point, which is the elastic limit. At this point, a fracture opens, and we go back along this curve. Okay. If the slope is less steep, we have the situation shown in the second picture. So in this second picture, we have a slope like this, and we go ahead, and from this point on, we have two intersections, one here and one here. Because these are local minima, they don't care that there is another intersection here, and they go up. They go up, but when beta comes here, there is no more equilibrium configuration for a higher beta in the neighborhood. So it is obliged to jump, because the only equilibrium configuration is here. So you see there, okay, this is the same picture. So we have two types of fracture. When this slope is steep, we have a gradual fracture. I mean, a crack opens, then the bar weakens because of the force which can sustain is slower, because U prime is a monotonic function of the force, okay? And on the contrary, when the slope is mild, you arrive from here, and at this point you don't have any equilibrium configuration, you are forced to jump here. And this is something dramatic, because this means that there is a sharp discontinuity in U prime, which means a sharp discontinuity in the force. Okay? So at this point you have an immediate loss of force. With a dynamical transition, because there is no statics there anymore, we don't analyze in which way we go from here to here. There are very far points in the configuration space. This is the configuration space, and there is no equilibrium path. And we go from one to the other. Physically, we should imagine some dynamic process. We don't wish to study it. So we say, okay, a dynamic process starts. There will be oscillations, depends. There will be some dissipation, I don't know. This is just a matter of complicating the model. But eventually, the only possible configuration with that beta is this one. And then, when beta increases, one stays on this branch forever. So you see, and which is the parameter which decides which is the mode of fracture? Is the slope. Slope 1 over L. And 1 over L, L is the only geometrical parameter which enters our analysis. And this is exactly the size effect we were speaking yesterday, because this means that with a small L, we have a gradual fracture. With a big L, we have a catastrophic fracture. So the model is very poor. There is just one geometric parameter, and this geometric parameter is decisive to see which is the mode of the fracture. So for small L, you have the behavior on the right, and for large L, you have the behavior on the left. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Yeah. But I will go back on this point. I will go back on this point. So we have to make a step forward here. Puoi far vedere la successiva, Francesco, per favore. The following slide shows how it is possible to construct by points the response curve. That means the curve which specifies the force as a function of beta. To do that, we use the boundary condition, which says that u prime, that beta, say, is equal to u prime plus 1 over L multiplied by the jump. Okay? And we use also the relations that sigma is equal to w prime of u prime, and it is also equal to theta prime of the jump of u. We have these relations. Okay, so the first graph on the left is just the constitutive equation of the elastic part, sigma, which is w prime of u prime as a function of u prime, for example, quadratic, just to be simple. The second graph is the equilibrium curve that we have just seen, theta prime as a function of sigma, then as a function. It is not exactly that, because we have seen here an equation u prime as a function of u. But as I said, u prime to the minus 1 of theta prime of u. Typically, if w is quadratic, this is a constant, okay? And in this case, we have proportionality between u prime and sigma. If not, we have a monotonic relation. So if it is not quadratic, that curve that you see there will be a little bit different from this, but okay, this is not important. So anyway, the second is a constitutive equation for the jump. And you see the curve is made of two branches, because you have this branch for the number of jumps equal to 1, and this segment for the branch with u equal to 0. Okay. So if the configuration is without jumps, the total, the relation between sigma, this is 0, u prime is equal to beta, and we have simply this relation. That is to say, you take the first curve on the left and you just put it into the space sigma beta. It's the same curve. Okay? When you have the jump of u greater than 0, we simply use this equation. Okay? Because in the we proceed this way, we fix sigma. Okay? In the first figure, we calculate u prime for that sigma. In the second curve, we calculate the jump for this sigma. Then we simply sum u prime plus L minus 1 of u, and we get the beta for that sigma. So the brown point on the right is a point of the equilibrium curve with jump of u equal to 1. We can repeat this for different sigma, and in this way we calculate the response curve. Okay. So what you see on the right is the response curve sigma beta. And you see that this curve tells us that initially we have an elastic branch. So when sigma reaches the maximum, you have the opening of the crack, and you can continue to increase beta, but the force becomes smaller. And this picture on the on the projector has been made for the case of L small. What happens if L becomes large? So this is the first part of the curve. If L becomes large, the second segment becomes smaller. Okay. If it becomes smaller, this very small, this initial slope is not negative, it's positive, okay? Because this term is very short. Okay? So we have something like that. So what means? Means that when I reach this limit value of beta, which I called beta c, at which we start with the inelastic deformation, I don't have equilibrium configurations anymore here, and I am obliged to jump down on this equilibrium branch. And this is the loss of sigma that I said before. The sigma drops from here to here and then continues on this segment. So we have a behavior like this. Elastic part, rupture, if you wish, Griffith rupture, because it comes without any inelastic deformation, just when you reach the limit point, and then you go with a stress, with a force which can also be zero, that depends on the form of the shape of theta. So, in a sense, this divides the response of the Barenblatt model into two big categories, large L and small L. For large L, you have brittle fracture, and for small L, you have ductile fracture. So this is small L, and this is a response for large L. Now we must see, we just spoke of equilibrium now, but we didn't say anything about stability. So we have to check which of these curves is stable and which is not stable. So our first result says that this part of the curve is stable, because this is a curve with zero jumps. And the sigma less than theta prime of zero. Theta prime of zero is at this point. This is sigma, this is theta prime of zero. Okay? So except this point, this vertex that I don't know, with the preceding analysis I say that the whole of this curve is made of a stable configuration, metastable configurations. Of course, the for instance, for this beta, the global minimum could be here, but I don't care about that because this is metastable, so certainly I will reach this point. What about the curve with jump equal to 1? Okay, here we have an inequality. And what means this inequality? Okay, I can write here. So, in each of these branches here, I can imagine that U prime and the discontinuity of U are functions of beta. Okay, if I am in this curve, at least locally, I can express the two as functions of beta. So, imagine this equation when these are functions of beta. If these are functions of beta, I can differentiate with respect to beta. And so here I have that W double prime multiplied by over beta is equal to theta double prime of u multiplied by d of u over beta. Okay, I am differentiating along one of these curves. But if I differentiate the other one, I have that 1 is equal to du prime in d beta plus 1 over L du in d beta. So I can substitute here. Instead of doing this, I prefer to do something more general, just to agree with the notation I will need later. So I consider that beta is a function of a parameter t. Okay. For what I am doing this now, this is completely useless because I am considering an increasing beta. Okay. So because everything is rate independent, I can identify beta with t. But in the coming lectures, we will need to consider loading and unloading. So t is a parameter like the time, which always grows, and beta may be an increasing or decreasing function of time. So I prefer to use this notation now. So instead of considering u prime and u as functions of beta, I consider them as function of t. This is purely formal now, nothing changes, but this is just to have a notation more general for the future. So in this case, if I consider them as function of t, I can put t here, and here instead of 1, I put d beta over dt, which in our specific case can well be equal to 1, no problem. And here is t, of course. So, for instance, I can eliminate this using this, and I can write theta double prime of u multiplied by this is equal to what? This is equal to L, which multiplies d beta over dt minus du prime in d beta. In dt, yes. So I can collect this du prime in dt here, and I can write w double prime of u prime plus L theta double prime of u du prime in dt is equal to L theta double prime of u d beta dt. So I am solving a system which I didn't want to solve, as a matter of fact. But let's write here what we got. So here we have one equation, which is this one. I made a substitution, but this is not really, I don't wish to make this computation. So I have here w double prime of u prime here, I am reading here, multiplied by this, which I, to be short, I write this this way, minus theta double prime of u time u dot 0. Okay, this is my first equation. So forget for the rest. I was going to solve it, but I. Is not the second is u prime dot plus 1 over L u dot equal to beta dot. Okay, so we have a system. A system whose unknowns are u prime and u dot, and the coefficients are known because I am supposing to be in a known, in a fixed point of this curve. Okay, so this is a 2π2 systems. I was starting to solve it, but I just give you the solution, which is quicker. And the solution is the following. Okay. U prime dot is equal to theta double prime of u divided by theta double prime of u plus 1 over L double prime of u prime. And u jump dot is equal to double prime of u prime divided by the same denominator, and both are multiplied by beta dot. So this is a solution. Yes, this is a linear system. No, yes, here. This is a theta second, so I'm sorry. Attention, yes. Beta prime is a tension given by the boundary condition, okay? And I wish to inquire about the stability, okay? So for the moment, I just solve the system which tells me which is the direction of the evolution at a given point of the equilibrium curve. No, no. No, this is quasi-static, and what is out? Extremely slow, so there is just one scale. Yeah, just one scale. Okay, so what we have at the denominator here is exactly this sum to within the factor L. And we have stability when this denominator is positive. Okay? So this tells us that W double prime is positive because of convexity, and the theta double prime is negative because of concavity. This means that these two quantities have a different sign. And that means that the slope of this curve is negative. Okay? So, I repeat, when we have stability, the slope of this curve has to be negative. That means that in this case, this curve is stable because the slope is always negative. But in this case, only the part with the negative slope is stable and the other one is unstable. Okay? I repeat, here I have negative and positive, and the denominator is positive in both cases. So the two have a different sign. That means that the slope is negative. So the only stable configuration are those for which the equilibrium curve has a negative slope. Okay? So this branch here is unstable. For long beams, we have an unstable branch. For short beams, we don't. Okay. Now, now I wish to show this is one response curve which gives us the force as a function of beta. Now we wish to draw a second response curve which gives us the energy as a function of beta. So the energy is this one. And we wish to express this as a function of beta. So this is constant, so we have L or W, and instead of u prime, I can write beta minus 1 over L, a jump of u, plus the sum okay. This is not very important in this context, but it will become important in a couple of days. In this way, in a sense, we have changed the representation of the energy. Before, in this special case of, for instance, of one jump, we had expressed the energy as a function of u prime and the jump. I mean, initially, the energy was a function of the configuration in an infinite dimensional space. Then we said, if we restrict ourselves to equilibrium configurations and just to one jump, we express it as a function of two variables. Now we made something different again. So just eliminate one variable by inserting beta in place of that variable. So we have another expression of the energy. I will denote it this way, with an equilibrium on the top, which is a function of beta and of the jump. Okay, which is this expression here. This is expression gives us some advantage because beta is given, usually. So here we have to calculate the beta with this formula, to calculate the beta with which this configuration is equilibrated. Okay. In this case, we just have a given beta, and we express the energy as a function of the jumps alone. Okay. I repeat, in this Barenblatt case, this is not very important. It will become important later. Let's now, here we consider as before beta, u and beta as function of t. And let's see what happens if we take the derivative with respect to t. Okay, we are along an equilibrium curve. So we differentiate along this equilibrium curve. So I write here, so this I am calling now E equilibrium of beta and u. And I take the derivative of this. So let's do the derivative. So we have L W of this quantity multiplied by beta prime minus 1 over L u dot W prime plus sum theta prime of u, of the x con e, multiplied by u dot of x con e. Okay. We have that these theta primes are all equal to W prime, equal to sigma, just by equilibrium. Okay. So we can write sigma, which is equal to both, multiplied by L beta prime, L beta dot, minus 1, minus the L cancels, U dot, plus U dot. This is sum of the U dot. No, this is just 1. So there is no sum here, because there is just 1 jump, plus U dot. Okay, so these cancel. So what we have found? We have found that that the sigma to within this factor L beta prime, L beta dot, is equal to the derivative of the energy. So the two curves are one the derivative of the other. Okay? So the response curve sigma as sigma of beta is equal to the derivative of the energy. Because this is a constant, beta prime can be equal to 1, then we have L, which is a constant. Okay? So this is true trivially if you have an elastic body, but this is true even here, okay? Just because of this computation that I made. The picture on the right is obtained by the response curve which we had drawn before by integration, okay? By integration. So we have, I explain it here. We have a first branch, which is, let's say, a parabola, which is the integral of the line, okay, of the initial line. And here is energy, and here is beta. And this point K here is just the beginning of the inelastic deformation, okay, which corresponds to the point H in the other picture. At this point, if we have a small length, the curve S, as you see, making the integral, this small s gives a positive contribution, and we continue to go, but at a lower rate. So the energy grows, but not as fast as before. On the contrary, when we have a large length, you see that at the beginning beta goes back. So from here, this is beta c, the beginning of the inelastic deformation, we go back. We go back with an unstable branch, okay, up to a certain point, which I called beta d in the first picture, which is the minimum beta reached in this, by this energy graph. And then, at this point, with this curve, I subtract area to the preceding graph. So the slope is negative in the energy picture. At this point, I start to adding area again. So I have a branch which is increasing this way. This is small, response of a small length, and this is a response of a large length. Okay? So this is exactly the same phenomenon as before, seen in the energy elongation response curve. So from here, it is evident that you go up to here, and here you have to jump here, and you lose this amount of energy. And this amount of energy is exactly the energy, the area, this area. Okay, this is a dissipated energy in this non-equilibrium process. While in the for short beams, you don't have any dissipation. Okay, and here you also have that when you go back, you have a recovery of you have another dissipation of energy. But on this second point, I will be back tomorrow. So as you see, the model is very simple, but gives you a rather rich picture, which gives you a vague idea of how this phenomenon of fracture work. Because with the introduction, with the Barenblatt regularization, we obtained an answer about the initiation of fracture and the size effect. So this is a big progress. With this very small regularization, we made a very big progress. And in the following lectures, I will show that further progress can be made just by small adjustments of this type. So that means that even if fracture is an engineering subject, okay, and one has to make experiments and to see what happens and so on, when comes the moment of making a theory, every detail is extremely important and one has to be exact, cannot be just approximate, because if not, you lose some fundamental items. Okay, so I finished what I had today to say today, and just in a few, 2-3 minutes, I will introduce the subject of the next lecture. The subject of the next lecture is what happens if we abandon the hypothesis of Barenblatt. That means the concavity of the energy. Okay. And this is extremely interesting. And as we see tomorrow, this has very much, very many points in contact with the first lecture of my colleague, Presutti, Enrico Presutti, what he did in the first lecture. I can explain to you just at the beginning, so tomorrow we have an advantage. It is possible to vary the shape of the energy theta in many ways. And tomorrow we shall focus in the following variation. We had a concave function. Now we wish to see what happens if we start with a small convexity here, and then we continue concave this way. Again, a small change, which changes everything.